restrictive lung diseases. Restrictive lung diseases are characterized by reduced expansion of the lung parenchyma and decreased total lung capacity. Restrictive lung diseases are characterized by reduced expansion of the lung parenchyma and decreased total lung capacity. There is proportionate decrease in total lung capacity and forced expiratory volume at 1 second. So, the FEV1 by FVC ratio remains normal as both these are proportionately decreased. The restrictive lung diseases occur in two broad conditions. First, chest wall disorders like severe obesity, pleural diseases, kyphoscoliosis, neuromuscular diseases like poliomyelitis. Second are chronic interstitial and infiltrative diseases. Example, pneumoconiosis and interstitial fibrosis. We'll be seeing about the chronic interstitial and infiltrative diseases in detail. Chronic interstitial lung diseases. These are of four categories: fibrosing, granulomatous, smoking related, and eosinophilic. Fibrosing lung diseases. These include usual interstitial pneumonia, also called as idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, non-specific interstitial pneumonia, cryptogenic organizing pneumonia, connective tissue associated disease, pneumoconiosis, and radiation pneumonitis. These are the major fibrosing chronic interstitial lung diseases. Next is granulomatous lung diseases like sarcoidosis and hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Third group is smoking related, which includes desquamative interstitial pneumonia and respiratory bronchiolitis associated interstitial lung disease. Last group is eosinophilic chronic interstitial lung disease, which includes chronic eosinophilic pneumonia. These are the four broad classification of chronic interstitial lung disease. The most important ones are pneumoconiosis, sarcoidosis, and hypersensitivity pneumonitis, which we'll see in detail. The first restrictive lung disease is pneumoconiosis. This occurs because of response of the lung to both chronic organic and inorganic particulate matter, but most commonly inorganic matter. The dangerous size of the particles are 1 to 5 micrometers, that is medium sized particles. Pneumoconiosis is of three major types: anthracosis, silicosis, and asbestosis. The pathogenesis of pneumoconiosis. Development of pneumoconiosis depends on amount of dust retained in the lung and airways, the size, shape, and buoyancy of the particles, the solubility of the particle, and physicochemical reactivity, and the additional effects of other irritants like tobacco smoking. These are the four causes of pneumoconiosis. All these stimulate the innate immunity cells in the lung, which cause the disease, that is pneumoconiosis. This is the basic pathogenesis. The first disease in pneumoconiosis is coal workers' pneumoconiosis, that is anthracosis. This is usually benign. The particles involved here are coal particles, which contain carbon. So when these particles are inhaled, they are engulfed by alveolar or interstitial macrophages called as dust cells. And these phagocytosed particles accumulate in the connective tissue along the lymphatics, like pleural lymphatics, or in organized lymphoid tissue like hilar lymph nodes. The anthracosis is of two types, simple and complicated. The simple anthracosis is characterized by coal macules, which are 1 to 2 millimeter in diameter and they consist of carbon-laden macrophages. Complicated anthracosis is characterized by progressive massive pulmonary fibrosis, which are multiple intensely blackened scars 1 cm or larger. They can be up to 10 cm. The simple anthracosis can sometimes lead to centrilobular emphysema. The location of anthracosis is most commonly in the upper lobe of the lung. The second pneumoconiosis is silicosis. This is common lung disease caused by inhalation of silica, which is pro-inflammatory crystalline silicon dioxide. This disease is slowly progressing nodular and fibrosing pneumoconiosis. The silicosis is the most prevalent occupational lung disease in the world. This is most common in people at risk who are involved in sandblasting or stone cutting. Pathogenesis of silicosis. The silica occurs in two forms, crystalline and amorphous. Crystalline form, example is quartz, which is most common, and there is also more fibrogenic. When the silica particles are inhaled, they are phagocytosed by macrophages. Then they stimulate the inflammasome, leading to the release of inflammatory mediators like interleukin 1 and interleukin 18. This is the pathogenesis of silicosis. The silicosis is associated with increased susceptibility to tuberculosis. The diagnostic hallmark of silicosis is presence of central collagen with peripheral zone of dust-laden macrophages. Important. And in radiography, eggshell calcifications are seen. So the diagnostic hallmark is central collagen with peripheral zone of dust-laden macrophages, and in radiography, presence of eggshell calcifications. The third pneumoconiosis is asbestosis. Asbestos is a family of pro-inflammatory crystalline hydrated silicates, which are associated with pulmonary fibrosis, carcinoma, mesothelioma, and other cancers of the lung. This is most common in insulation industry workers, and location, it involves the lower lobes of the lung. Important. This is the only pneumoconiosis which involves the lower lobe of the lung. The pathogenesis of asbestosis. Asbestos particles occur in two forms, serpentine form and amphibole form. The serpentine form is the most common, approximately 90%. Amphibole form is more severe, that is, it is more fibrogenic. The pathogenesis is same as that of silicosis. That is, when the asbestos particles are inhaled, they are phagocytosed by macrophages. And the phagocytosed particles stimulate the inflammasome, which lead to the release of pro-inflammatory factors and fibrogenic mediators. This is the pathogenesis of asbestosis. Next is morphology. Asbestosis is marked by diffuse pulmonary interstitial fibrosis along with the presence of asbestos bodies. So, asbestosis is marked by diffuse pulmonary interstitial fibrosis along with the presence of asbestos bodies. When the asbestos bodies are deposited with hemosiderin, they are called as ferruginous bodies, which is characteristic of asbestosis. The asbestos bodies are golden brown fusiform or beaded rods with translucent center. They consist of asbestos fibers coated with iron containing proteinaceous material. So, asbestos bodies are golden brown fusiform with translucent center, and they consist of asbestos fibers coated with iron containing proteinaceous material. The most common manifestation of asbestos exposure is the formation of pleural plaques. These are well circumscribed plaques of dense collagen, which are often calcified. So, most common manifestation of asbestos exposure is formation of pleural plaques. They develop on the anterior and posterolateral aspects of the parietal pleura. Lung is covered by pleura, which we all know is of two layers. Parietal pleura, which is the outer layer, and visceral pleura is the inner layer. So, the pleural plaques develop on the anterior and posterolateral aspects of the parietal pleura. The most common malignancy associated with asbestosis is adenocarcinoma lung. But the most specific malignancy, that is, it is most specific to asbestosis, is mesothelioma. The most common malignancy associated with asbestosis is adenocarcinoma lung, and most specific malignancy is mesothelioma. So this is about three types of pneumoconiosis: anthracosis, silicosis and asbestosis. And that is all about pneumoconiosis. We'll see about sarcoidosis and hypersensitivity pneumonitis, which are granulomatous restrictive lung diseases, in our next video. Thank you.